Customer CTO of SHI, Henry Faster. Welcome.
Welcome. Pleasure to be here.
So let's talk about cloud. So
okay.
Are you using cloud? And tell us about the cloud stuff that you have.
Okay, so SHI is actually a cloud provider. SHI is actually a cloud provider. Most people know SHI as a large-scale VAR. We sell technology. Want me to just talk straight ahead? Okay. So, I think most people know SHI as a large-scale reseller and a VAR. We sell all of the the technology products as well as professional services in that space. About 18 months ago, we started thinking about what we were going to do to be a cloud provider, a cloud service provider. And so, offering infrastructure as a service is a logical extension of what we already do. So we sell a full range of technology products as well as professional services. Offering customers infrastructure as a service is just a natural evolution of what we do and who we are.
So you guys went out and built your own infrastructure as a service offering.
Yeah, exactly.
So can you walk us through that? What does that look like? Okay. Where is it hosted, et cetera?
So our infrastructure as a service offering is targeted a very specific section of that marketplace. One of the things that we did 18 months ago was to talk to people about what was it that they wanted to be in the cloud. What were their concerns? What were the issues around that? And you heard the obvious things. You heard security. People were concerned about security. But one of the things that came across was usefulness. How useful were virtual machines that I was going to get from the cloud be for me?
Right.
So our approach to this was to provide what we refer to as industrial grade virtual machines. So we provide virtual machines that are of the same quality as a customer would provide from their own infrastructure. The virtual machines are projected onto the customer's network. So rather than accessing our network, we project the virtual machines via VLAN extensions onto the customer network. Now, that does a couple things. By placing them on the customer's network, you have a layer of structural security. Because now, once we deploy the virtual machine, we have no access to that virtual machine. By placing it on a customer networking segment, it becomes indistinguishable from the customer's own infrastructure. So they can take our virtual machines and mix and match them with virtual machines from their own infrastructure, even physical machines. They become indistinguishable from one another. The second thing that we did in this space is to provide a mission-critical quality infrastructure around it. So, many cloud providers in this space are sort of reticent to talk to you about what their infrastructure is. We're exactly the opposite. We are completely transparent about what our infrastructure is because we've built it in a mission-critical way. So there are no single points of failure in any of our architecture. Our data centers are tier 3+ data centers. We even provide redundant network carriers with redundant entrances into our facilities. So we provided a completely redundant facility.
So does mission critical to you? Talk us through that, there's IT best practices, which mm-hmm. you can't ignore, right? Mm-hmm. And a mission critical to a lot of guys is just is a brand.
Mm-hmm.
But the reality is to participate in the cloud economics, mission critical can't necessarily be achieved by acquiring brand X, Y, or Z. So how do you guys get to mission critical, get to cloud best practices without paying through the nose for expensive enterprise stuff?
First and foremost, we actually did use enterprise class. We felt that if you're going to offer a mission critical quality, we don't use any white boxes, we don't use any shareware, no freeware. We use all first tier products across our facility. Secondly, the facility is designed in a completely redundant and resilient fashion. So there is no single point of failure anywhere in our architecture. So that the two keys to doing this are using name brand products, as well as deploying it in a completely resilient format.
And multi-tenant. So I guess, how do you get to the economics of cloud? Because there's very public benchmarks that if I came to you and said, well, Google's doing this for server mm-hmm. admin, Amazon's doing this for storage, mm-hmm. and how do you match up against that? At a high level, it seems to be hard.
The difference is our target marketplace. And so, we're not targeting the casual virtual machine user.
Right.
We're not targeting the small company that, needs a few virtual machines to do development. We're creating virtual machines that a customer can use to deploy applications, deploy their business critical applications. And so the cost model is different for that. And so the cost model that we're, you know, that we're compared against is the cost model for a customer to create mission critical infrastructure to deploy their business, their line of business applications. So it's not that we're going to compare our cost model with the lower cost providers in the space, but compare it to the cost of mounting mission critical virtual machines for a customer internally.
Right.
Now having said that, when you look at our overall cloud pricing, our cloud pricing is very competitive with the people who don't provide the same quality of infrastructure that we do.
Well, application-wise, what are you seeing as the early profile for where these, what these guys are putting on your cloud?
All over the lot. I wouldn't even say there is a profile. We see all types of applications being deployed to the cloud. We also have software customers who would like to deploy, essentially deploy software as a service, but deploy it for individual customers. So, for example, one of our early customers is a company called LabVantage. They're a provider of laboratory information management software. And so, so when they sell a LIMS system to a customer, normally, the customer is going to have to provide a hardware platform for that to be landed on. And so, and that would always lengthen their sales cycles and make their sales cycles more complex. They now offer a complete package. They offer their software loaded on our virtual machines, and then we simply deploy those virtual machines. And so, in a way, it's SaaS, but it's custom SaaS. It's software deployed for each individual customer. And so, we see that as a very common trend. Software providers, who want to get away from having to deal with infrastructure, but don't have a product that's particularly amenable to general purpose SaaS.
Henry, can I just jump in for a second here?
Sure.
I know you had a good conversation there, but we talked to a lot of cloud providers, and multi-tenancy, all that stuff has to talk about. It's kind of shaking itself out. It's good. Mm-hmm. It's okay, but security is always the hot topic. Mm-hmm. So obviously, you guys got the mission critical. Talk about this, your approach to security.
Sure.
And because obviously that's hot, and RSA tokens have been hacked, and PlayStation's, obviously impact there has been well documented. So it's always a concern.
But of course.
That's not stopping people. They're still going to the cloud. So talk about security in particular.
So we've taken two approaches to it. One that's structural. So the fact that we deploy our virtual machines on the customer's network, means that, no one other than the customer has access to those virtual machines, including us. So one, that provides a great degree of structural security, from a penetration point of view, because those machines are protected by the same security that the customers put up for all of their machines that exist on their network.
Which might not be secure.
and I have a professional services organization that can help them with that, so okay. That's okay. We can work on that problem, too. Secondly, each portal is customized and exposed only to each individual customer. So there is no, there is no general portal that's exposed to the internet. Each customer who signs up with us has their own portal that is exposed only to them. We provide structural capabilities. Again, on the structural side, we provide for complete encryption of all data at rest. So no customer has to be concerned that, a service tech comes in and swaps out a disk drive and their information goes with the, with the disk drive. So along with, the structural security elements that we've provided, we do the normal layered security you would expect around intrusion protection and so on and so forth. We use a variety of products from McAfee. You mentioned RSA, but we use RSA keys for our encryption of data at rest. But we also do something that's a little different. We use a company called, by the name of Solutionary, to monitor our cloud centers. And so they monitor the same security log files, all the same things that we monitor. But they monitor them and notify us in the event of any kind of intrusion, but also notify our customers at the exact same instant they notify us. So that customers can feel very good.
I could talk about this for hours. I've got three more hours. This is such a great topic. Security and cloud, it's fantastic. Tell the folks out there, because we only have a couple more minutes, so I want to just get the last final question in about your business and how what's happening around the business of your company and how HP fits in there. Because obviously you're here at HP Discover, mm-hmm. and we've been here for 2.5 days trying to get to the root of extracting all the knowledge out of the show and where HP fits into the main trend. So I'd like you to tell me about your business quickly, and then how does HP plug into that, and what do they do to help you get there?
So much of our cloud is based on HP hardware and software. software. So we use Hewlett-Packard servers, their blade capabilities. We use their networking capabilities. We use their storage capabilities. You know, one of the interesting things, you know, a lot of people have asked me why we chose HP networking in all of this. And, you know, because of the very nature of the way we deploy virtual machines, since we're, you know, we're projecting them via VLAN extensions, I need, you know, full support for MPLS, I need large-scale VLAN support, and I need Q&Q support, which is part of, you know, large-scale VLAN support.
Right.
And so HP networking absolutely provided the best combination of those things. Also, you know, cloud is more, much more about software than anything else. And so, you know, HP has a lot of the building blocks, particularly around the automation components. And so, you know, if you think of the products that HP got from the Opsware acquisition, so, you know, OO, NA, SA, all of those products are part of the automation layers in our cloud. So the, you know, the network provisioning, storage provisioning, server provisioning are all fully automated using those products. And so, you know, HP had a very nice collection of products. And then as part of their converged infrastructure program, they had done some of the integration associated with those things. Now, I'll be the first to tell you, we had to do a lot of integration to make this all work. But the fact that HP had provided, you know, a fair amount of integration to start, you know, at least reduced the tasks that we had, you know, that we had.
So the magic glue to keep it all together isn't yet a product, it's still your process?
It is our integration capabilities as well as you know, IP that we've created. There's a variety of things that we've done that we've actually applied for patents on, you know, in terms of standing up our particular brand of cloud.
So then do you bring that on site to customers and help them build clouds too on
the
VAR side of the business?
We do, and as a matter of fact, we you know, we do that in two ways. We have a capability that that's called managed private cloud. And so our internal infrastructure is arranged in something that we call vCores, but the generic name for that is a service core. And so it's a finite collection of servers, storage, and switching elements that we replicate over and over again to add capacity. Those vCores obviously can exist in my center, but they can also exist in the customer's center, still managed by my cloud centers. So that's what we call it, managed private cloud. Okay. The customer has some of the advantages of private cloud without having to buy all the software to manage all that. But on top of that, we also provide a private cloud. So, you know, we'll transfer our technology to a customer and install true private cloud based on our technology. The customer at that point can manage that private cloud themselves, or we will manage their private cloud for them from our cloud centers.
Right. Good stuff.
Okay, well, Henry, thanks so much for coming on theCUBE. We really appreciate it.
Oh, my
infrastructure
pleasure.
As a service, a great success story for HP. Obviously, it's a hot area cloud. You've been there, you built it up, and best of luck with your business. Thanks for coming on theCUBE.
Pleasure.
Appreciate
my pleasure.
It.